Good evening, Rock Church, and welcome Sunday night, 9:83. Welcome. Good to see everyone, and good to see everyone that's online. Who we got? We got Glenys and Adam and Charles, Susan, Becky, Rachel, Karen. 13 other people, but Anne, I can't see who you all are. Great to see you. Hope you've had a good day. Let me have a look on here. Sherry, Clive, Jenny. I think we said Rachel. William. Great to see you. Well, welcome guys tonight. I don't know if you had a chance to tune in to our Sunday morning service, but we were so encouraged and we were so blessed. What a great morning we had this morning. We had the drums and the keys in the worship team this morning, and we also had Comrade and Sarah leading us, and we had such a great time. It was wonderful. Amen. So just let me know if you can hear me okay. Just give me a thumbs up. Ola, good to see you. Victor, Sharon, great to see you. Just press the like button just so I can see that you can hear me okay. You can see me okay. Becky said it was amazing. Anne said it was good morning. Worship was great. It was really exciting. Thanks, guys. At least I know you can hear me now. You can see me and you can hear me. Okay, guys, now listen, let's get into Psalm 83. If you're tuning in for the first time, my name is Pastor Ian. I'm from the Rock Church here in the West Midlands, United Kingdom. And we are here in the 83rd night of lockdown of the UK. And we are in the 83rd Psalm. So we have met together consecutively for the last 83 nights. We've been blessed, we've been encouraged, we've been excited. And everyone that you see that's online is the Church Without Walls, if you like, the Church Online family. And we're here together just to grow in our relationship of knowing Jesus as Lord and Savior, and getting to know the Word. And it's great that we're over halfway through the book of Psalm at this moment in time. And God's been teaching us and God's been showing us. Hi, Joy. We're just excited that God has kept us, protected us, provided for us. He's been with us this last 83 days. There's no shadow of a doubt. God has and still is with us. So let's have a look at this then. Let's have a look at Psalm 83 and let's just see where God's going to take us. We've been reading this last 11 chapters or so from Asaph, and this is the last one. Okay, so this is the last psalm that was written by Asaph, and so we're going to say farewell to the worship leader, farewell to the temple court leader of worship, known as Asaph, and this is the final one. So let's just have a look on there. It says, a psalm of Asaph. O God, do not remain silent. Do not turn a deaf ear. Do not stand aloof, O God. See how your enemies growl, how your foes rear their heads. With cunning, they conspire against your people. Isn't that interesting? I've just seen that myself, to be honest with you. See how your enemies growl. Now, quite often we hear the scripture says that the enemy roars, he roams and he roars. I think this might be the first time that I've seen the word growl in the Word of God. That might be the first time. Maybe it's because the translation I'm using, I don't know, but certainly up until tonight, the psalmist hasn't used that word before, and I think that's quite interesting. See how the enemies growl. You guys know that I've been on a bicycle this last week. Yesterday we went on a men's bike ride, and I think it was five or six of us that went on a bike ride, and I've been amazed by the beauty of Warsaw, amazed by the canals and the towpaths. But yesterday, on the way into church, we'd done the bike ride, and then after the bike ride, I cycled into church, and it was the first time a dog's chased me on the bike. since I've been riding the bike. And so I went past the bike, and I drove past the dog, and this dog was just fixated, I think, with the rotating wheels. So the dog decided to chase me a few hundred meters down the road. It wasn't as scary as it sounds. I don't think the dog was trying to bite me, right? But he was growling. And so when I've just seen that word there, growling, and sometimes people's growls are worse than their bite. Sometimes people's growls are worse than their bite, meaning that sometimes people are all talk and all threats and they're bullies, but yet they don't have anything to back up their growl. 2,000 years ago, the penalty, the power, the authority of Satan was taken from him. 2,000 years ago, Jesus came from heaven to earth, right? And he took away the penalty of sin. Jesus took upon himself, he became the sacrificial lamb, which meant he took away the authority of sin. I've said this before, I'm gonna say it again. One of my favorite stories I've ever heard was of a father driving in a car with his 4 or 5 year old little daughter on the back seat. A summer's day, all the windows were down in the car, they're listening to the radio, they're singing along, and as they're driving along, a bee flies into the car. The little 4 year old girl is petrified of this bee. She starts screaming, "Daddy, daddy, the bee, it's gonna sting me, it's gonna sting me." He's driving on the road, trying to find somewhere to pull over to deal with this incident. And so as he's driving, trying to pull over, he's reaching in the back of the car where his daughter is seated, trying to grab hold or waft this bee out of the vehicle. He grabs the bee. Right, he grabs the bee. The moment he grabs the bee, the daughter goes silent. It's now safe. The bee's been grabbed, but the inevitable happens. The bee stings the father. And as the bee stings the father's reaction is to release that bee. So he releases that bee. The moment the bee starts flying again, right, the daughter starts screaming again, the bee, by this time the father's pulled the car over into a lay-by and he turns around to the daughter and he says, "Look, as the bee's still flying around, still making bee noises, still looking like a bee, still intimidating the 4 or 5 year old daughter," the father turns around and shows the daughter the sting of the tail of the bee that is now in his hand. And he turns to the daughter and says, "Sweetheart, look, the power of the bee is now in my hand. The sting is in my hand. He can't harm you now. It can't touch you now. It has no power. It has no authority. And the scripture says, death, oh, where is your sting? Where is your victory?" Because Jesus took the sting of the bee. So Jesus took the sting of the devil, which means that he can come round and he can growl, but his growl is worse than his bite because he has no bite. The teeth of the lion, the teeth of the enemy, the teeth of that dog has been taken out. The devil can look like a lion, he can growl like a lion, he can intimidate you and you think he has power. He has no teeth, he has no sting. Christ at Calvary has taken the power. And I just love that there. I hadn't seen it before. See how your enemies growl. Listen, let me tell you right now, you are a son and a daughter of the Most High God. You are a son and a daughter of the Most High God. No matter how many people are growling at you today, no matter how much the media is growling at you today, no matter how much propaganda is growling at you today, no matter how many people are telling you you should be petrified, you should be scared, you should be intimidated, no matter how much people say that to you, you are free in Christ. They have no authority over you. There is no power of the devil in your life now. Those lies are lies. that deception is deception. See for what it is. The devil will whisper to you and say, I've got you. He hasn't got you. Christ has got you. You're right in the center of his hand. You're right in the center of the cleft of the rock. Christ has got your back. He is faithful. And he's faithful to complete the good work he started in you. So victory, death, where is your sting? Sin, where is your victory? I am telling you, because of the blood of Jesus Christ, the enemy can growl but cannot bite. Come on now. The enemy can growl but cannot bite. We thank God. See how your enemies growl, how your foes rear their head. Verse 3, with cunning they conspire against your people. They plot against those you cherish. Come, they say, let us destroy them as a nation. See that Israel's name is remembered no more. With one mind they plot together. They form an alliance against you. The tents of Edom and the Ishmaelites of Moab and the Hagrites, the Byblos, the Ammon, the Amalek, the Philistine, with the people of Tyre. Even Asherah has joined them to reinforce Lot's descendants. Do to them as you did to Midian, as you did to Sisera and Jabin at the river Kishon, who perished at Edor and became like dung on the ground. Make their nobles like Oreb and Zeeb, as the princes like Zeba and Zalamana. Wow, these are good ones, aren't they? Who said, let us take possession of the pastures of God. Make them like tumbleweeds, my God, like chaff before the wind. As fire consumes the forest, or a flame sets the mountains ablaze, to pursue them with your tempest and terrify them with your storm. Cover their faces with shame, Lord, so that they will seek your name. May they ever be ashamed and dismayed. May they perish in disgrace. Let them know that you, whose name is the Lord, that you alone are the Most High over all the earth. Wow. Asaph is praying to God here about the people of Israel. One thing you find really interesting, when you look at the history and the story of the Jewish people, when you look at how many millions of Jews were put to death in gas chambers, who were murdered just for the fact that they were Jewish, this nation in Israel that is the size of Wales had, like no other nation on earth, has faced so much persecution and yet still survived. It's incredible that as of today, there are more people, more Jews alive today now, right, than that was murdered. You see, Adolf Hitler, that whole regime tried to wipe out the Jewish people, and they nearly did. But God's faithfulness is so great, it's so massive. And you find here that the psalmist is asking God, right, that he would turn up and he would show up and he would protect his people. Let me tell you, through all the pain, through all the suffering, through all the murders, this people group has never ever been wiped out, but yet has had more persecution than any other people group on the face of the planet. Why? Because what Asaph prays here about the Jewish people, about God's people, what he prays over these people works. Amen. God's protection works. God's favor works. And even though there is loss, and even though there is pain, if you give God the space and if you give God the room, He will come through. He has got your back. He is your God. He is your Lord. I don't care what the bee says. I don't care what the growling enemy says. I don't care what the devil says. The devil wants you to disbelieve who you are. You see, the greatest battle there is over your life is the battle of your identity. Listen to me now. The devil will want you to identify in anything else but in Christ. He'll want you to identify in your sexuality. He wants you to identify in your birthplace. He wants you to identify in your job. The devil wants you to identify in your gifting, in your ministry. He will want you to be identified by anything other than Christ. You see, when your identity is in anything else other than Christ, you'll never be the complete package that God's called you to be. You'll never have the authority that God's given you. You'll never walk in that authority. If I identify myself as pastor, if that's where my identity is, and that comes before my identity of Christ, of being a new creation, if that comes before that, game over. Amen? The devil, I'll never be able to operate as a pastor or as a leader in real authority if my identity is wrapped up in that. So therefore, I don't fully lean upon God as my identity. I lean upon my gifting or my anointing or my job or my position or my title. So the devil will have the identity of what you do, right? So therefore we go, well, that's John the doctor, or that's Sarah the dentist, that's Mike the mechanic, that's Bob the builder. You all know Bob. Your identity should not be in what you do. What you do is a byproduct of your identity. Therefore, I identify in Christ, and because my identity is in Christ, I actually outwork my gifting or anointing or whatever it might be. God's called me to be a doctor. God's called me to be a shop owner. God's called me to be whatever it may be. And what that is insignificant. You know, we get impressed when we see a doctor and we think a doctor's better than a mechanic, a mechanic's better than a shelf stacker, a shelf stacker's better than, you know, we find so much security in the identity of what we do. Listen, don't identify in what you do, but identify in who you are in Christ. Identify in who you are, because the release of authority in your life, the doors that will open in your life the moment you start identifying as a child of the Most High God, as you start to identify as a child who is adopted and grafted in, as you start to identify the fact that, hey, forget everything, forget where I've come from, forget what car I drive, forget what job I do, forget whether I'm single or married. Don't identify me by any of that stuff. Identify me as a son of the Most High God. Therefore, my background will not keep my identity. Where I'm from will not keep my identity. I identify as a son of the Most High God. At the age of 15, when I gave my life to Jesus, that's when the old man with the old identity, with the old, well, this is who I am, this is what I think, this is my learned behavior, this is my experience of life, all of that was put to the side because a new man came alive in me. A new man came alive in me. And some people cannot let go of the old man. They have too many eggs in one basket. They cannot let go. They have to identify themselves in the car they drive, or the house they have, or the kids they have, or the job they do. They have to identify themselves as this person from this background that has it. Identify yourself in Christ. In Christ. So, you find that Asaph here is praying for the people group, the nation of Israel. He's praying for them, right? And he's praying for them, but we've now been grafted in. We've now been grafted in. So therefore, at this time, Asaph wasn't praying for us. We weren't adopted. We weren't grafted in. We weren't part of this people group. But when Christ came, we now got grafted in. So where all the way through the Bible, the identity of who they were was so important. But when Jesus came, he changed it from the identity of who they were, right, to the identity to who they are. Therefore, it means now that you do not need to be in the family tree, right, of Abraham, Jacob, or Isaac. You, by faith, can be grafted into the promises of God. So therefore, if you're here this evening and you say, well, this is who I am and this is how I think, or I have no identity, I don't know who I am, I don't know who I think, hold on here a minute, forget that, because you're identifying with the flesh, but now you are not flesh, you are now spirit. Your spirit is alive in your flesh, but your flesh no longer identifies you or leads you. The spirit in you, your spirit, not the Holy Spirit, your spirit is now alive, and the Holy Spirit now reveals to your spirit who you really are in Christ. Before you were formed, before you were born, whilst you were in your mother's womb, I knew you. I knew you. Before you learned any language, before you learned English or you learned Afrikaans or you learned what, before you started to get identity of what school you went to or what food you ate or what background you came from, I knew you. He formed you in your mother's womb. Your identity was placed into you in the mother's womb. Meaning that the moment you bowed the knee to Jesus and started to realize that, hey, he knew me, he formed me, he created me, he's put promises on me, he's identified me, I can now say I am an overcomer, I can now say I'm a man of God, I'm a child of God, I can now say he's my father. What other identity do you want than that? Our identity in Christ, the very thing that the devil wants to challenge in your life and wants to challenge in my life, is, are you really who God said you are? Did God really say that? Adam and Eve were hit with that. Did God really say, question mark, not to eat of that fruit of knowledge? Did God really say not to get that fruit? It's going to make you smart. It's going to make you wise. You know, wisdom is knowledge. Knowledge is wisdom. So therefore, does God really not want you to have knowledge? Surely not. God wants to give you knowledge. I'm telling you. It's not the knowledge up here that's important. It's the knowledge in your spirit that's important. The moment you know that you are who the Bible says that you are, fear goes. Depression goes. Anxiety goes. Struggling to find identity, where do I belong in life, is no longer your thing that you seek. Some people struggle to find, well, who am I? Who am I in life? Where do I go? Who am I? I don't know how to identify. No. Don't identify with who you are in this life. Identify with who you are in the kingdom of God. This life is temporal. This life goes like this. So therefore, you need to identify in the kingdom of God. Who are you in Christ? Everything else is secondary. Everything else is just okay. But when once you know that you are who God says you are, that he is your father, you are his daughter, you are the apple of his eye, that you are born for such a time as this, that you are predestined, that you are chosen, that he is there for you, that he will never leave you, and he'll never forsake you. My goodness, the moment you start to identify in Christ, the devil's teeth disappear. The devil's sting disappears. Amen. There's no more power. There's no more authority in that. But the moment you believe what he says, the moment you give him the authority back, see, the devil doesn't have the authority now. It's been taken away from him. But who has now been given the authority? You have been given the authority. the authority to cast down and to bind, and authority to loose, the authority to speak things that do not exist as if they exist. So therefore, if the devil whispers a lie in your ear and says, you are nobody, you are nothing, blah, 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 you're never going to get an opportunity, you're never going to advance forward, you're never going to overcome, you're never going to achieve, you always fail, you're going to fail again, and you turn to the devil and go, yeah, you're right, I never failed. The moment you say that, the lie of you will never succeed and you will fail, that lie and that deception, you've now given that legs, you've now given it authority by saying, oh yeah, I always fail, I never survive. The moment you say it, you've spoken authority into the lie of the devil. So this is what we need to do, church. We need to understand what's truth and what's lie. Because if we get those two mixed up, then we just go endlessly through life, hitting peaks and troughs. We go endlessly in life, just not knowing if we're coming or going. We need to know what is truth and what is lie. So when the emotion, right, says this is true, because it feels true, and we've gone through a situation, this is true, right? When that emotion says that and it feels true, our understanding of who we are in Christ stops it and goes, I don't care how true it feels, it's a lie. But when we don't know what's truth and what's lie, and when we don't know what our identity is, and when we're getting told by many different people who we are and how we should think and what we should think, then we go into confusion, and then our emotions, we just whatever our emotions say is truth. So we live on our emotions. If we feel happy, it's truth, we're happy. If we feel sad, it's truth, we're sad. If we feel lost, it's truth, we're lost. If we feel persecuted, it's true, we're persecuted. If we feel victimized, it's true, we're victimized. If we feel lonely, it's true, we're lonely. So our emotions tell us what we're feeling. Our feelings tell us, right, our truth. But that truth is a lie. When we get the word of God and our emotions say, you are a loser, you are a dropout, you are a nobody, you are a nothing, and no good things are going to come from you, the truth challenges the emotion and the feeling that's very real and says, no, I know I feel like I'm lonely, but I'm not. In fact, I went to church this morning. I went online to the Rock Church and I heard that I have an angel with me. That's what we talked about this morning. And I heard where the prophet Elijah said, man, I am the only one that's left. I feel lonely. I feel sad. I feel gutted. I am the only prophet left. That's truth. God came along and said, that's not true. There's 7,000 prophets that haven't bowed the knee. You see, your emotion of what says is true, right, isn't necessarily true. So don't be led by the emotion of truth. Be led by the word of truth. Come on now. It's so important, guys, because emotions are real. Emotions are strong. Emotions emotions are real, right? And most of us are led, you know, I've said this before and I'll say it again. A lot of people's way that they're led by the Holy Spirit. They're not led by the Holy Spirit. They're led by the emotions. But this is how people think they're led by the Holy Spirit. They go, oh, I just felt right. That felt right. I went there and da da da. And that didn't feel right. And I felt really at peace. Oh, I didn't feel that peace. I felt uncomfortable. And people think, right, that is the leading of the Holy Spirit. Now, at times that can be, but really that's your emotions, right? You think every good emotion is God saying yes, and every uncomfortable negative emotion is God saying no. Let me tell you, don't trust your emotions, trust truth. Don't trust your emotions, trust truth. Know the truth, and the truth will set you free, right? Sometimes I can't remember the name of that film. You can tell me what it is. When he's an army officer and he's in the courtroom and he bangs on the table and goes, "You can't handle the truth." Some people can't. Some people don't want the truth because the truth would challenge their lifestyle. The truth would challenge the way they talk. The truth would challenge their direction in life. It would challenge the people they hang around with. So sometimes people don't even want to know the truth. They want the truth of their emotions rather than the truth of the word. Sometimes, guys, we can't handle the truth, but we need the truth to speak into our life. If we don't allow truth to speak, we'll just continue on through this life, self-opinionated, driven by our own, thanks Adam, a few good men. You can't handle the truth. He's in the courtroom and they say to him, "Tell us what the truth is. Tell us what really happened. Tell us what the truth is." Right? And he bangs the table and goes, "But you can't handle the truth." Church, can we handle the truth tonight? Can we really handle it? Can we handle it? Right? Or are we uncomfortable in our heart thinking, "No, I don't like what he's saying there. I don't agree with what he's saying." No. I identify in where I've come from. I identify in which part of the planet I was born. I identify in that. No. Let's identify in Christ. You are dead to self. Dead to self. I tell you, I don't know how there's no nice way to put it. If you're dead, you're dead. If you're dead, you're dead. Dead to self, and allow the truth of the Word of God, the truth of the Spirit of God, the truth of the Holy Ghost to rise up inside of us, and every emotion and every thought and every word and every action gets weighed into the light of truth of the Word of God. Hallelujah. So Asaph, we say goodbye to you. Asaph, we say thank you for taking us on this journey. Thank you that your heart was to pray for people. Your heart was to pray for the nation. We thank you, Lord, that you put the words of Asaph in your word. And I just love that phrase, right? That phrase that Asaph has used. See how your enemies growl. Guys, the enemy may growl at you this week, but the enemy can't bite you. All he can do is growl at you. But some people, when they hear the growl, they think that they've been bitten. When people hear the growl, they hit the floor like they've been bitten, like the dog's bitten them. No, the dog hasn't bitten you. The dog's just growled at you. The enemy's just growled at you. Do not allow the enemy to have any of your authority that you own, that has been paid and given to you by the blood of Jesus Christ. If you would like to know Jesus as Lord and Savior tonight and you've never invited him into your life, would you do me a favor? Would you just bow your heads with me? Will you just close your eyes? I'm going to say a prayer. I'm going to leave a little gap in between my words. And in that gap, speak boldly, speak strongly, and repeat these words. And this is an introduction of you knowing Jesus as Lord and Savior. Let's just bow our heads for a moment. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Father God, thank you for sending your Son, Jesus. Jesus, you came from heaven to earth. You came to be a sacrifice for sin. You came to be my sacrifice, to take my punishment, to pay my penalty. Jesus, you didn't deserve to go to the cross, but that's how you took the sting out of the devil's tail for me. That's how you took the teeth out of the devil's mouth for me. The devil has no authority on me because of what you have done, Jesus. I repent. I bow the knee. I ask for forgiveness. I'm sorry for my sin, my wrongdoing, my selfish actions. I choose to identify in you tonight. Come into my life. Come and make your home in me. I choose to live for you today. and this day forward, in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. We thank God and we praise God. Let's just rejoice right now. Just press that like button. This look like an online cheer. An online cheer. And if you're watching this back and you see these, you said that prayer and you see all these hearts and fun likes go up, that's just the online church just celebrating that you've given your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. Never change your mind. Never slow down. Never walk back. Connect with the church. Connect with people online. Find out how to pray. Find out how to worship. Find out how to move forward in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. So, we hit a new week this week. Day 84 tomorrow of lockdown. Psalm 84. It's the beginning of a new week. We're sitting on a Monday. Please pray for our food bank that opens Monday and Wednesday. Great news about food bank. The demand for food bank has radically dropped. I mean, we were like busy at one point, and now the demand for it, the need for it, has definitely lessened, and we thank God for that. Amen. Where we thought it was going to get busier and there was going to be more need and more desperate people, it's actually got less, and that is such a good thing. The busier we are, the worse the scenario and situation is. The quieter we are, the better it is. So we thank God that people are managing better now with finances and with food than they were at the beginning. So I want to just give that praise report first. So, but we still are doing food bank Monday and Wednesday. But it is available all week. If people do need it, let us know. Chuck us an email, send us a message, give us a phone call. All the contact details, phone numbers, etc., is online, is on the Facebook page. On, I think it's Wednesday evening, there's a ladies' Bible study that happens every week, and there's information on there. We went on a men's bike ride on Saturday. Instead of having our men's Zoom meeting, and we're going to look at doing the same again this Saturday because we had such a great time. Nobody fell in the canal, even though Rosario did jump over the canal. It didn't look that far. He jumped over the canal and got stuck on the other side and he couldn't jump back. But this is how God provides. He's trying to jump back, but he's second guessing himself. And as we're waiting, a big barge comes along and the guy allows him to walk across the barge and get on the other side. So God supplies in so many different ways. I think I've got a video of that, so we could maybe even show that tomorrow just for a bit of fun. So we had a great time of fellowship and it was great meeting the guys. Obviously social distancing in place, but we went on probably about a 15-mile bike ride and it was just great. It was great. And God was good to us with the weather as well. Praise God. So on Saturday we'll be doing men's bike ride. The ladies are also having a ladies breakfast. I think that may be this Saturday, but again the information is on Facebook, so there's stuff out there for the ladies, stuff out there for the men. And if you need to phone or have a chat, just do so. We're here in the office every day 9 to 4. We're in the office, so you can give us a call. Also, just to let you know, that we've got a radio station. And the radio station is on therockchurch.co.uk, and there's a play button on there, and it's 24 hours a day worship, and it's really encouraging. It's a real blessing, and we're starting to get some presenters come in now, and we've got Wayne doing an amazing job, we've got Nick doing an amazing job, and every day from 12 to 1 o'clock there's a request hour, and now we've started recording those request hours to replay them on the evening. So twice a day, right, there would be a request hour. It would be live from 12 to 1 and then it'd be pre-recorded, and I think it's at 7 o'clock. But tune into the Rock Radio, it will really encourage you. May God bless you, may he make his face shine upon you, may the anointing of God be with you. We pray for those who need healing, be healed in the name of Jesus. those in need of touch, be touched in the name of Jesus, and continue to pray for this nation and for the leaders of this nation, that God's words will come forth in this nation, in this time that we're in of Corona, and this time that we're in politically. May the peace of God reign in this nation. May we see revival. May we see a touch of God that's so big and so powerful that nobody can argue with it, that this is the Lord our God, strong, almighty. Great meeting with you guys. Same time, same place tomorrow night. Hannah says hi. The kids say hi, right? And I can't wait till we meet face to face. But tomorrow we will be cracking on to Psalm 84. We applaud Asaph and for the journey that he's taken us on. And for me personally, you may have some guys personally, I'm just loving what Asaph has said there about the growl, right? See your enemies growl. Remember, you may get chased on your bike by a dog, but all it's going to do is growl. Between last Saturday and yesterday, on this bike, which has been so much fun, I've done 130 miles on the bike. Can you imagine? Not all of it me. I've got this electric assisted. So let's say about 3 miles me and about 127, 8 the bike. No, I've done it. We've done half each. Got a good partnership, me and the bike. We've got a good arrangement. The bike does half, I do half. And so it's been great fun. So have a blessed evening. Have a great sleep. See you in the morning in the mighty name of Jesus.